Good morning, everybody. I hope you guys had a great last week. Last week was actually my last week of summer, which means that tomorrow I start my senior year of college. Woo! So please pray for that. Before we get started, I'd like to read a verse from Psalms 100. Let's stand together while I read it. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Let's worship him now.
You are
with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the
commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else can make every king bow down? Who else could whisper in darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What of the beauty demands such shines the sun. What of the majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy. Consumes like fire. What of the power can raise the dead? What of the name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only.
Dear Heavenly Father, you are our one and only God, and for that we are so grateful. Thank you that we get to come before you and worship you while being filled with joy. We know, God, that it was you who created us, and we are your people. This morning, we want to enter your presence and thank you for all that you've done for us. Your love is so good, God. 1 John 4:19 says, we love because he first loved us. And for that, God, I pray that we never take your love for granted. You are our Father, our Creator, and the only God. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen. Greet somebody next to you.
Southwest family, we are so thankful that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. As we direct you to some upcoming events, I want to remind you that the registers will be making their way down the aisles. And if you are new or don't know what the registers are, this is a great way for you to let us know who you are, a little bit about yourself, and that you are here. And if you look at the bottom of the page that will be there, this will be an opportunity for you to fill out a prayer request. And hello to those who are online. I almost forgot to welcome you, but thank you for joining us here at worship online. And for those who are online, there will be an option for you guys to fill out the register as well. But for those who see the paper copy, there will be an area at the bottom for prayer requests. And it is a delight for us here at Southwest as a staff to pray for you all for the many requests that you guys have. And those requests really do come to us, and we have the privilege of praying for you during the week. And so if there's something on your heart, if there's something going on in your life and you would like prayer, we invite you to fill out that bottom portion so that we can be praying for you. And a couple of things that are coming up ahead of us here. On August 27th, there will be a women's fall kickoff brunch. Sorry, guys, nothing for you yet. But this will be on August 27th, which is a Saturday from 9:30 to 11. And this will be an opportunity for you all as women to come together, have some breakfast, which is always a good incentive. And you guys will hear some testimonies from people here at the church, as well as hear about what is going to be happening in the women's ministry this coming fall. So I invite all the women to sign up, which you can sign up either through the weekly newsletter that comes out for our church, as well as online on the events page. So sign up for that. The other thing that is coming up quickly, as we transition from summer to fall, I'm sure all of you guys have felt that there is a lot of things happening. You guys are getting busy. If you guys have kids in school, I'm sure things have just taken off, and there's probably a list of things that you guys have to accomplish in the next few weeks. But starting September 7th, our kids programming, our clubs will be starting. And so if you have a child the age of 4 years old up to sixth grade, you are welcome to bring your kids to clubs on Wednesday nights this fall. And so if you have kids that are 4 years old to sixth grade, or you are a child or someone in from 4 years old to sixth grade, you are welcome to come to clubs on Wednesday night starting September 7th. It'll be a lot of fun. I don't know actually what you guys do there, but everyone's running around and having a good time, so it seems like it's a fun event on Wednesdays. And just to draw your attention to how you guys can connect or get plugged into Southwest Community, there is a very resourceful and informational welcome desk in the back, and we have some great volunteers who are often there at the beginning of services and at the end of services, in between, that can help direct you in how you can get connected or plugged into our church here, how you can be a part of what's happening here. So whatever your age is, whether you're a girl or a guy, there is a ministry out there for you, a way that you can serve, get plugged in, get connected, so that we can in fact be the community that we strive to be. And so if you haven't been back there already, even if you've been here for a long time, or if this is your first time or first few weeks here, I'd invite you to go out in the Welcome Center after the service here, see all of the different resources we have for the ministries, and get plugged in. That is a great way for you to meet new people and begin to be a part of the family here at Southwest Community. And so finally, before we get into God's word this morning, I want to pray with you guys, and specifically for Pastor Than as he brings God's word to us this morning. And so if you could join me in prayer. Lord, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you for the nice weather outside, Lord, and for another opportunity for us to gather together as a community and worship you, Lord. We ask that you would go before Pastor Than as he brings your word to us, Lord. And would you guide and direct his thoughts and his words? Lord, would it be your words and not his? And Lord, so would you calm any nerves, Lord, and would you direct his thoughts and his speech as he shares with us from your word? And Lord, would we have open hearts and open minds to you, to your word? And would we be transformed by your word? And we would leave differently than when we came. And so, Lord, would you go before Than? Lord, would you quiet our hearts in this time? Would we be open to what your word has to say to us this morning? We ask this in your son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. How is everyone? Oh, good to hear. I'm so glad. So a question, what would make a perfect rock climbing day? What do you need in order for it to be just the right kind of day? Now, I've done some extensive research in order to figure this out, which means I watched one YouTube video. Not exactly. But there are some things that you need in order to make sure that it's a good rock climbing day. You need the right equipment. You definitely need something to help you get up the wall. And why not start with the right shoes? The right shoes will really help you be able to move up that wall and grip the way you need to. Of course, you're going to need a harness. That harness is going to keep you safe while you're going up the wall. And in addition to, you're going to need a carabiner. Now, a carabiner can't just be any type. I have been told that you need the locking kind of carabiner, and that will help you on your journey. In addition to, you will also need some type of belay device. The belay device will be run by the person on the ground to help you move up that wall successfully. And of course, you're going to need a bucket bag with chalk in it to keep your hands just the way they need to be. Now, at this point, you may be thinking, hold it, you're missing one of the essential ingredients in order to make sure that you can climb well. And I would tend to agree with you. We're missing one of those key ingredients. And so, to that end, if you were going to have a perfect rock climbing day, what would you use to climb with in terms of, well, let me show you. Would you use this? Or maybe you're not that kind of risk taker. And instead you think this might be a little bit better. Could really help you move up that wall successfully. Or maybe you're thinking, no, still not good enough. I'll use one of these. Or maybe you're still going, no, this seems rather foolish. I'm not putting my trust in that. I want something like this. And if not something like that, could I at least maybe have something more like this to help me get up that wall? What we put our trust in matters. Sometimes it matters just a little bit. For instance, what kind of gum am I going to chew to make my breath smell minty fresh? That's not really that important. Or what kind of dog toy am I going to buy so that Fifi really loves me? Another not that important. But if you're gonna rock climb, a little bit more important. Today, we get to explore trust. Today, our passage is a warning about putting our trust in the wrong place, and also a beautiful example about putting our trust in the right place. We are again in the book of Luke, and if you have a family worship guide on you, you'll notice that you have another periodic table, books of the Bible. On the screen behind me, you'll see an example of this in the periodic table, books of the Bible, breaks down the Bible into two big sections. You got the Old Testament, you got the New Testament, they're all bright colors. But we're not focused on the whole Bible today, so we're gonna gray out one side, and the Old Testament has been set aside for right now. We're gonna look at the New Testament, and in the New Testament, we don't wanna look at all 27 books, we actually just wanna look at one section, and that single section is the Gospels. It's not Matthew, it's not Mark, but it is Luke. So today we are going to look at Luke chapter 18, starting in verse 9. I'd like to invite some of my friends, Miles and Gabe, up to read our passage this morning. And would you all stand in honor of the reading of God's word? Let me make sure it's on. There you go.
Okay. And, okay. He also told us parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, "God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this task collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithe of all that I get."
But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted.
Thank you, Gabe. Thank you, Miles, very much. I appreciate it, buddy. You may be seated. So we have another parable that we're exploring today. Ultimately, where we put our trust matters. Look at the setup of this particular parable. We have two characters, both that have every opportunity to put their trust in themselves. Why? Both have power. The Pharisee has the power of religion and reputation. The tax collector has the power of government and money. The Pharisee is the subject of Jesus' teaching 27 times in the book of Luke. It might be easy for us to say, you know what? We should look at the Pharisee, and when we look at this Pharisee, we should see that this Pharisee truly is the bad guy, and quickly can become the punching bag in our modern church times, because we can describe them as being religious without relationship. But if we slow down and we look at this group of people, the Pharisees, there can be some very revealing things about them. Tracing the root word back to its Hebrew origin, Pharisee means to divide or separate. We must ask how a group of people attempting to follow God got to the point of thinking they ought to be separate from one another or from others. If you follow the Israelite people through the Old Testament, there is a precedent for separation. If you remember last week, we looked at how God established himself as provider, replacing Egypt. He was provider. He wanted their attention. He wanted them to see him as their provider. He provided quail and manna. If we look at the Old Testament as well, you can find the Ten Commandments, and God was against any divided loyalty for his followers. Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 through 6. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in earth beneath, or that is in the water underneath the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commands. As one author put it, Pharisaism tried obedience to the law as their way to follow God. It was to represent a peer community, to be the true people of God, to prepare for the coming Messiah. There are some right things in here, being a peer community, being the true people of God, being prepared for the Messiah. Those are right things. Where this goes off course is when following the rules superseded the reason for following the rules. When the following of the rules becomes an end in and of itself, that is dangerous. Why? Why is this dangerous? Because it moves our focus off of God and back onto us. It moves it from the rule maker to the rule follower. Before long, we're following rules in some twisted comparison game like we find in the prayer of the Pharisee in our parable today. When I follow rules because I follow rules, it becomes a system of works based on my behavior. When I follow the rule maker based upon reverence for God and a love for him, it is a response to wanting to please God. The distinction deeply matters and is even emphasized in the passage we just read in the Ten Commandments. Exodus 20, verse 6 states, "Of those who love me and keep my commands." If we just have keeping commands without the love, it turns into a works-based system of righteousness very quickly. If we have love of God as the motivator behind keeping the commands, we fix our eyes on God and not on ourselves. If we read the book of Luke too quickly, we might assume that Luke always makes the Pharisees out to be the archetypal bad guys. However, we see Jesus eating with the Pharisees on a number of occasions in Luke 7:36 and in Luke 11:37 and in Luke 14:1. His love for the Pharisees is deep and vast. Remember that Jesus disciplines those he loves, as Hebrews 12:6 states. So Jesus may well be using the Pharisees as a category of people because he deeply loves them and wants to correct them out of their misguided rule following. Jesus' love also extends to the tax collector, the other character in our parable today. We know Jesus' love extended to tax collectors as he called Matthew to be one of his 12 disciples. For many Jews, the archetypal bad guy was the tax collector. They could easily be seen as the ones that sold out, the ones that sold out to Rome, the ones that are possibly irredeemable. When we meet these two characters in our parable today, they're on their way to church, at least in a sense. Luke 18:10, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and one a tax collector. Both are heading up to the temple to pray. We've explored the subject of prayer last week in the sermon, and today we're going to explore the attitudes we have as we approach God. Remember, both these characters have every opportunity to trust themselves because each of them have different types of power. The Pharisee has the power of religion and reputation. The tax collector has the power of government and money. As the Pharisee approaches God, his misguided trust in his own power of religion and reputation shapes the approach. Luke 18, verse 11. The Pharisee says, God, I thank you. I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I get. Did you notice how many times the word I was used in that prayer? In two sentences, the Pharisee mentions himself five times. Maybe the prayer is much more about himself than his God. Compare this to the tax collector's prayer. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He does refer to himself. The tax collector says, I'm a sinner. But it's quick and simple. There's much evidence that the tax collector's prayer is focused on God. It could be said that when you set the two prayers side by side, they quickly reveal what each man is trusting in. The Pharisee is trusting in his own accomplishments. The tax collector is trusting in the mercy of God. Inaccurate trust drives arrogance. Accurate trust drives humility. The Pharisee's inaccurate trust in his own accomplishments drives arrogance as he proclaims in his prayer a grand comparison between himself and others. The tax collector's accurate trust drives his humility. See the words again of the tax collector. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He's off by himself. He won't look up, knowing his place compared to God's place. He beats his breast. Again, this is done off by himself in a place where people aren't watching, off in the corner, not out in front. He does this as a true response to God. His accurate trust drives this man's accurate humility, evidenced by the simple and powerful words, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Inaccurate trust drives arrogance. Accurate trust drives humility. There is a difference between arrogance and confidence. We can see confidence endorsed in prayers like Psalm 17:3-5. You've tried my heart. You've visited me by night. You've tested me, and you will find nothing. I've purposed that my mouth will not transgress. With regard to the works of man, by the word of your lips, I have avoided the way of the violent. My steps have held fast to your paths. My feet have not slipped. Psalm 26:1, vindicate me, O God, for I have walked in my integrity. I have trusted in the Lord without wavering. Both those prayers are confident, but not in the prayer, but in the prayer's God. There's a big difference in how far the Pharisee goes in his prayers and how far Psalm 17 and Psalm 26 go. The Pharisee's inaccurate trust in his accomplishments and contempt for other people leads to a stance of disgusting arrogance. Both Psalm 17 and Psalm 26 anchor their trust in the Lord. This is why the psalmist is confident. The Pharisee, however, is not confident in God. Hear his words again. God, I thank you, I'm not like other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even this tax collector. Extortioners were in the practice of obtaining something through force, especially money. The unjust were in the practice of living by what was morally wrong and unfair. Adulterers were those that pursued voluntary sexual intercourse between themselves and someone that was not their spouse. Tax collectors were in the practice of collecting unpaid taxes. In New Testament times, a person who was a tax collector was despised. Tax collectors earned a profit by demanding a higher tax from people than they had prepaid to the Roman government. This system led to widespread greed and corruption. The tax collecting profession was saturated by unscrupulous people who overtaxed others to maximize their personal gain. Rabbinic sources consistently align Jewish tax collectors with robbers. The Pharisee is confident in himself. The Pharisee is supposed to be the righteous one, yet the most righteous thing we can possibly do is realize that righteousness on our own is pointless, empty, and a waste of time. The Pharisee's trust in himself reveals the deep sickness of sin. The most damning phrase is when the Pharisee says, "And God, I thank you, I'm not like other men." Really? Revealing just how much he is like other men. While the Pharisee may not have been in the categories he listed, he's a whole lot closer than he realizes. Jesus leaves no room for what an adulterer actually is. Matthew 5, 27 and 28, Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery,' but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart." This standard that Jesus has means that the Pharisee better check himself. The Pharisee may not be known as a robber, as the tax collectors were often categorized, except for the fact that he was stealing the dignity of another human being before a holy God, as he seats himself on a great high pedestal above the tax collector. Do we ever thank God that we're not like other men? Before we immediately jump and answer no, slow down for a moment and ask yourself in the quietness of your heart, ask your God in the quietness of your heart, do I ever compare myself to other people to make myself feel better? Do I compare myself to other people to defend my own sinful actions? Do I compare myself to other people to show off for my friends or to show off for a person that I might be attracted to? Do I compare myself to others to tell God why I'm worthy of his time and attention? Is there a form of comparison that we do in life that's even more subtle and just as insidious? Do we only look for our friends when we enter a room because they're the ones that make us feel comfortable? Ultimately, do we play a comparison game, making friends more valuable than the newcomer? Have we not, with our actions, labeled the newcomer as an outcast, one to be forgotten? Do we purposely avoid certain types of people because they look strange? They look different than us. They speak a language we don't understand. They've made a statement with their fashion choices that puts them in an untouchable category for us. They make less than we do. They wear shoes that are the wrong brand. They make more money than we do. They've been to prison. They seem too good to be true. In order for us not to play the comparison games in our brain and think more highly of ourselves than we ought, as instructed in Romans 12:3, we have the other character in this parable. The tax collector, who also had the power of government behind him and the power of money in his pocketbook, could have prayed a very similar prayer to the Pharisee. Instead, his approach is much the opposite. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not lift his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." Somewhere along the road of life, this tax collector had figured out that all his power did not mean much before a holy God. Somewhere along the road of life, this tax collector had gotten to the end of himself and seen that he was not as important as his position might have allowed him to appear. This could have been because people despised him, but we do not know. What we do know is that his attitude is full of humility. He stands back off, far, maybe in a corner. He keeps his head bowed, unwilling to even look up, and he beats his chest. When does a person beat their chest? They're either acting or they beat their chest because they don't have words to express what's inside their heart. Have you ever been so desperate, so full of emotion? So at the end of your rope that the only response is to convey something with your hands? How do we know this is his posture? Because his words match, "God be merciful to me, a sinner." This accurate trust drives his humility. We also need accurate trust to drive our humility. I might have said, "God, you're my Savior, save me," but I need to continue to come to him in humility. I need to approach his throne and say, "God, I need you. I am a sinner. I'm no better than the person who I walked in with or passed on the car. I'm no better than someone who walks in this door early or late. I'm no better than this person or that person for any reason on earth. I deserve to be punished, and yet what you give me is grace. I deserve to suffer eternally, and what you give me is mercy." This kind of prayer puts me again in a correct place before a holy God. That is a prayer that accurately captures all of our places before a holy God. It is reverent, accurate, humble. This is followed up by Jesus' words as he provides an explanation for the parable. He says, "I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other." The man in verse 14 is the tax collector, and the word that is used is the word justified. In this context, another way to say that verse could be, this man went down to his house in right relationship with God. He knew his place and position, a sinner. He knew his need, mercy. He knew who could meet his need, God. Jesus finishes this explanation of the parable with these words: "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. But the one who humbles himself will be exalted." The Pharisee exalts himself, and Jesus says he will be humbled. The tax collector humbles himself, and Jesus says he will be exalted. Have you ever noticed it's hard to pick out the humble? They can be easily missed for the flashy, the loud, the obnoxious, and the arrogant. How can we be a people who value what God values? Part of the way we can do this is to deeply internalize being the praying people God calls us to be. Over the last 2 weeks, we've explored prayer. Last week, we were instructed to consistently pray and not lose heart, so that when Jesus returns, he finds us faithfully in pursuit of him. This week, we are told the kind of attitude we're to have in prayer. We are told to be God-focused on what he can give. We are told not to be self-obsessed. We are told not to put our trust in ourselves or our accomplishments. We are told to be humble, understanding our place before a holy God and how that should play into all the relationships with people around us. All of this roots back to where we place our trust. We cannot just say with our lips, "We trust you, God." We must live it. when we're looking for how to attitudinally align with God and appropriately understand our place before him, we need to look no further than to the book of Psalms. Psalm 34, verses 1 to 3, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Psalm 51, verses 1 and 2, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Psalm 37, verse 3, trust in the Lord and do good, dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. Psalm 119, 41 and 42, let your steadfast love come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your promise, then shall I have an answer for him who taunts me, for I trust in your word. At the beginning of our time together, we talked about climbing. We talked about all the right gear. The Pharisee, he was like a man that had the right shoes. He had the right harness. He had the right carabiner, the locking kind. He had the belay device. He had the bucket bag and chalk. Yet, he was putting his trust in his own merits. And putting his trust in his own merits, that's like climbing using a thread. Using a thread to rock climb is a really good way to end up dead. Relying on the mercy of God is like you threw all the rock climbing gear away and you ask God to put a jetpack on you, and then you ask him to helmet and bring you safely to your eternal home. Inaccurate trust drives arrogance to believe we're good enough on our own. Accurate trust drives humility to know we are always in need of God's mercy. Who we put our trust in eternally matters greatly. Accurate trust can be greatly shaped by the words of Scripture. A powerful place that we've already looked in is the book of Psalms. Of the 283 direct Old Testament quotes in the New Testament, 116, or 41% of them, are from the book of Psalms. Just to give you a quick idea of the general topics in Psalms, you can look at the pictograph behind me. Here you can see all the different categories, and there's a number of them. Lament, imprecations, royal, God is King, Messianic, Zion, praise, thanksgiving, trust, and wisdom. There's a lot of Psalms. And if you have the family worship guide, you've got a copy to take home. If you don't have the family worship guide, you can go fight someone for it. No, don't do that. If you need one, please let me know. I'd be happy to get you a copy. As is fitting, as we close our sermon, I'm going to ask all of us to humbly turn our hearts to God, and not only turn our hearts, but turn our very bodies humbly towards God. If you are able, I invite you to kneel with me as I pray Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. In whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and my foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I have, I've asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart says to you, your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you who have been my help, cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Give me not up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they breathe out violence. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Oh God, may this be our prayer. Amen.
Let's stand together.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do with my arms extended.
Oh,
Southwest Church family, this last Wednesday night, we gathered as the people of God to praise and to pray as part of one thing. You can see a few pictures behind me on the screen from us joining together. And in addition to, we had the opportunity in the middle of that evening to write prayers for our church. And those prayers are inside the prayer chapel over there. You're welcome to go look at them. There are also extra sheets of paper for you to write your own prayer for our church. I encourage you to do that in the vein of what we've studied the last 2 weeks together about prayer through the parables found in Luke chapter 18. May we do that in an air of humility, and may we be consistent prayers that do not lose heart and that realize who we are before a King that is worthy of all glory and power and majesty and honor. And may you go in that strength this week. Amen.